أصول الكرم وقادة الأمم وأولياء النعم. For the happiness of Hazrat Zahra-i Marziya, for the enlightenment of the graves of your marhumeen, of the graves of the shuhada, ulama, and siddiqeen, for the safety of the followers of Ahlul Bayt around the world, and for the safety and the hastening of the reappearance of Hazrat Baqiyatullah al-A'zam Marwahun al-Fida, please recite your loudest salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad
al-Salih. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who's Rahman and the one who's Rahim. We have for the past 3 nights been looking at Ziyarat Jami al-Kabīrah of Imam al-Hadi salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. And one point that I have been stressing is that everything that I have said thus far is not the peak of Ali Muhammad, but this is in reality all that we can bear to understand of Ali Muhammad. Otherwise, their maqam is far greater than anything that we can comprehend. The second thing is that we must learn to reclaim the narrative. It is unfortunate that, as I said yesterday, that a Salafist Wahhabi ideology has also infiltrated our mindsets such that we are now trying to reduce the maqam of Ali Muhammad. Whereas in reality, our kalam, our study of aqa'id, our belief system is that Ali Muhammad, the Holy Prophet, and Ali Muhammad are the highest of all the creations of Allah. There is no barrier that is between them and Allah. They draw directly from Allah and pass it on to the rest of mankind. And so we've reached this part of Ziyarat Jami al-Kabīrah where we address Ahlul Bayt as Awliya al-Na'am, that you Ahlul Bayt are the Awliya of Na'am. Awliya is the jam' of the word Wali. The word Wali, it means friend, custodian, has multiple meanings, owner or guardian or master. Na'am is the plural of the word Ni'mat. Ni'mat in its lughati form, directly translated as is, means something that is soft or delicate. But when used in terms of conversation, Na'ma is then something which we define as a blessing that has been placed upon mankind that is for their benefit, and the human being uses that Na'ma and gains enjoyment from it, a sense of happiness from it. So we're addressing Ahlul Bayt here as Awliya al-Na'am. You are the masters, you are the owners of all of these blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these blessings. So today we'll go into depth as to what it means for Ali Muhammad and how is it that they are the custodians of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By this point, as I said yesterday as well, you already have this structure of existence within your minds. Tawheed, underneath which is the realm of wilaya, underneath which is the realm of the world, the mulk. Everything that comes from Tawheed enters first into the realm of wilaya to the wali at-tam, who then distributes it towards the lower beings within the realm of wilaya, then eventually it reaches this world. Every ni'mah that you see in this world is but a fraction of what that ni'mah actually is. Everything you see in this world, if you see fire in this world, that fire is not the reality of fire. It is but an emanation of what is true fire. The fire that you have here is the fire of the Akhirah cooled down 70 times till it enters this realm. Not everything that you have here is at its peak. Nothing in this dunya, that's the nature of the dunya. It is something that is almost like, you know when you have mufflers on your ears and you can't hear properly, and then someone covers your eyes with some sort of eye patch and you can't see properly, and you're wearing gloves and you can't really feel anything. You feel something. The example of the dunya is like that. When you enter into the akhirah, then these mufflers are removed. These hijab in front of your eyes are taken away. And that's where you really learn what a ni'mah is. That's where you truly understand. That's where you can actualize many realities. Like right now, I don't want to go off topic, but just that I've said it, like right now, when I say to you flower, or I say to you chair, in your mind, you have created a flower and chair. For all intents and purposes, that is your creation. It is your mumkinul wujud. The only thing is you don't have the power to bring it out from immateriality to reality. But the awliya of Allah did. Isa alayhi salam did. He imagined a bird, he fashioned it, he blew life into it, bi-idhnillah, and it became a bird. But in the akhirah, you will be able to. Because someone asked the Imam, says that in Jannah, will people be able to have children? And the Imam says, yes, of course. He says, but how is the process of children? Will there be this whole process of pregnancy, 9 months waiting till the child is born? The Imam says, no, like Adam. The person will in their mind, I want a child will appear. They will it in their mind. And that from that their mind, it comes into reality. Comes into reality. Here in this realm, your powers, your abilities are restricted. You have to work harder to be able to get to the higher realms of existence. And even then, the nature of the dunya is such that you are cotton-wooled almost from what is reality, from what is the actual, what it actually means to live. So all of these ni'mah that you have here is all but a small fraction of what the real origin of that ni'mah is. It's but a small fraction. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the na'imah in the Holy Quran, He says in Surah Luqman, verse 20, He says, أَلَمْ تَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَأَسْبَغَ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَهُ ظَاهِرَةً وَبَاطِنَةً. He says, have you not seen everything in this heaven and earth? Allah has created for you. Has created for you and has bestowed upon you ni'mah, both apparent and hidden. Both apparent and hidden. In Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He addresses the human being. He says, Yabna Adam, khalaqtu al-ashya alak. I have created everything for you. Everything in this world is for you. It is at your disposal. But I have created you for me. I've created everything in existence for you, but don't forget, I created you for me. And so this is all at your disposal, but within the parameters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for you. All of this is for you, but I created you for me. And then when you begin to go towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now it's not, I created you for me, that's part of it. But then it also becomes that I will make you like me. Hadith changes. It says, Ibn Adam, atta'ni, obey me, so that I can make you like me. So that I can make you like me. So Ibn Adam, I am the living that shall never die. Obey me, and I will make you the living that shall never die. O son of Adam, I am the one that says to something be, and it will become. Obey me, and I will give you the ability to say to something be, and it will become. This is This is nothing. To live eternally for Allah to bestow is nothing. Allah to give you the power to create is nothing. But there's only one thing that He wants from us in order to be able to give you all of that. Ubudiyyah, servitude. He says, I've created everything for you. Everything is subservient to you. وَخَلَقْتُكَ لِأَجَلِّي. But I created you for me. But I created you for my worship. So Allah in this Holy Quran, in the ayah of the Holy Quran, is saying, look, everything in the heavens and the earth has been created. And we have given you apparent na'mah, and we have given you hidden na'mah. Na'mah of your batin, that you do not see. The first type of na'mah is that na'mah that you can touch and you can feel and you can smell and you can see, all of that. But those na'mah are below the higher level of the blessings, are those blessings that you cannot see. Those batini blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows on a person. Imam Ali salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, no, he says that ni'mah for the human being, he says, ala wa inna min al-na'am, that from amongst the ni'mah that Allah has given you, sa'at al-mal, it is wealth, an expansive wealth. وَأَفْضَلُ مِنْ سَعَةِ الْمَالِ, but greater than lots of wealth is صِحَةُ الْبَدَنِ, it is the health of your body, the health of your body. This is a greater ni'mah than wealth. And then he goes on, وَأَفْضَلُ مِنْ صِحَةِ الْبَدَنِ, but greater than the health of your body, تَقْوَى الْقَلْبِ, it is the taqwa in your heart of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For that is the one thing that will last forever. Wealth comes and goes. Health will come and go. No matter how much wealth you have, if you've got bad health, you don't enjoy that wealth. If you have bad health, you can never achieve everlasting. If that health, your body is weak and diseased, ubudiyyah becomes difficult for you. If you're weak, you see some people who just don't have, young people, don't have the ability to sit on the floor anymore. Don't have, every time they walk into a center, they're looking for a wall to lean against because that core strength is gone. So how is it then that they will be able to recite Salatul Layl? How is it that they will be able to spend the night in the ibadat as is recommended by our a'imma alayhi wasalam? Siha, the strength of your body is linked to your spirituality as well. But the Imam says the spirituality is greater than the physical health of your body. But in such a small example, you see, someone who can't sit on the floor, then how will they sit to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because they'll constantly be like, oh God, Joshan Kabir, long one, why have they put the slow reciter on? It's going to take forever, and they can't, because there's no enjoyment in that worship. They don't enjoy it because one reason, the lack of their physical strength to be able to do that ibadat. Nonetheless, the Imam says the greatest of all of these ni'mah is that taqwa in your heart. If you have that, that will not only give you greatness in this dunya, but it will also give you greatness and you will reap its reward in the akhirah. But if you have diseases of the soul here, they will impact your badan, they will impact your wealth, and they will impact your akhirah. If you have a disease like jealousy, for example, jealousy is an all-consuming fire that won't allow you to see anything. And the jealous person will burn all of their wealth in order to drop the one that is the target of their jealousy. And they won't care. They will stay up late at night trying to bring down someone whom they are jealous of at the detriment to themselves. And that's just one disease of the soul. There are multiple diseases, and how they manifest, they affect both your body and your soul. So various ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you in this world. The ni'mah of children. The ni'mah of a spouse. The ni'mah of wealth. The ni'mah of clothing on your body. The ni'mah of sight, of hearing, of taste. All of these ni'mah, ask the worth of these ni'mah from those that no longer have them. Ask the ni'mah of youth from those that are elderly. Ask the ni'mah of sight from those who are struggling to see. And they will tell you how important that sight was. So all of these ni'mah, the ni'mah of touch, taste, smell, everything that you have in your life that is good is a blessing from Allah. It is a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But greater than those physical ni'mah are those spiritual ni'mah, the ni'mah of the batin. And it is the ni'mah of the batin that will help you in the akhirah. On a day where your good looks won't help you, on a day where your arrogance and your wealth and everything won't come to your aid. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. It's a day where neither wealth nor children will come to the aid of a person. All that matters is that qalbi salim, having that peaceful, submitted, pure heart. That is what will be weighed on that day. People will try. There will be someone that will be brought forward. And they'll say to him, you took part in the sins of the flesh while you were in the dunya. For this you will be punished. And he will say, but Allah, it wasn't my fault. It's a riwayah. Says Allah, it wasn't my fault. Says, what do you mean it wasn't your fault? Says Allah, if you hadn't made me good looking, if you hadn't made me good looking, members of the opposite gender would not have been attracted to me. And thus I wouldn't have fallen into these sins of the flesh. Allah says, so you're saying, if we had made you ugly in the dunya, you would not have committed the haram that you did. Says, yes, because you made me good looking, it made me weaker, and I ended up doing the haram of the flesh that I did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, listening to this, orders the caller to call out, and where is Yusuf? Yusuf alayhi salam comes forward. Remember I said yesterday that the women, or the day before, that the women who cut their hands were women that had seen Yusuf all these years that he was there. But now all of a sudden they look at Yusuf again and they don't realize they're chopping their hands off. Because Yusuf alayhi salam at that point let out a tajalli of his true batini form. Of his form in Yawm al-Qiyamah. I said, this dunya, everything is cotton wooled. Everything is suppressed. It's not able to shine as it should. And so now Yusuf alayhi salam, Allah says, bring Yusuf forward. Yusuf comes out in all his majesty, in all his good looks, as was supposed to be. Comes forward, now tell me, were you better looking or is Yusuf better looking? How is it that Yusuf saved himself? Same riwayah comes for women. It says, call forward Maryam, the daughter of Imran. Was she better looking, or were you? So how is it that she was able to maintain her haya? But you didn't. That realm, all that will matter is the purity of the heart that you had here. See, this heart is so important. The Urafa, they say, al-qalbu yataraddadu bayna al-mulki wal-malakut. Parallel to this dimension is the realm of the malakut. It is the driving force of this physical realm. Here you see rain falling, but in the malakut of the alam of this world, there is an angel bringing a droplet down. But here you only see rain falling. Here you see mountains steadfast in their place. In the malakut of the alam, there are angels holding that mountain down. Says al-qalbu yataraddadu bayna al-mulki wal-malakut. Your heart, not this thing in your chest filled with cholesterol and all sorts of visceral fats, but the spiritual heart, yataraddadu bayna al-mulki wal-malakut. It is your connection between the mulk and the malakut. You can enter that realm, and you do enter that realm. When you sleep, you enter that realm. That barzakh is within the malakut. When you sleep and you dream, your soul leaves your body, it enters that realm. And it is easy and it is possible for you to enter the realm of the barzakh, if you choose to concentrate on it. But the entry, the key card for the entry towards the malakut is the pure heart. When this heart rusts, this revolving door that connects you with the immaterial, semi-immaterial realm begins to get jammed and leaves you here. And that's why as you grow older, you don't dream as much. Because that heart, that key card has become rusty. That door is jammed shut. And so you don't dream as much. You don't get those feelings as much. Deja vu, all of these things, they're all linked to the malakut of the alam. It's all linked to that realm. And the entry into that realm is your heart. If it allows you to enter that realm, then Yawmul Qiyamah is that realm as well. And it will be the purity of that heart that will be weighed. And that heart can only be filled with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more of the love of God that exists in the heart, the more this heart begins to transcend. And the higher in the malakut you can go while still being here. Allama Tabatabai rahmatullah alayh says, I was praying Salatul Wutaira after Salatul Isha, and in the rak'ah, the first rak'ah of Salatul Wutaira, I was reciting Surah Sa'd. Says the angels came, they took me to Jannah, they showed me the Nahr of Sa'd, the river of Sa'd, a mukashifa. That entering that realm isn't difficult. In theory, in practice is difficult. Because you have to control your eyes and your ears and your tongue and everything. And make sure that nothing lives in your heart but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا جَعْلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. Allah has not given a man two hearts in his chest. So reciting this, it reminds me, one day Sayyidina Zainab was sitting on the lap of Amir al-Mu'mineen. She's 3 or 4 years old. Says to Amir al-Mu'mineen, says, Father, do you love me? Imam Ali says, yes, of course I love you. Says, Father, do you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Says, yes, of course I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the 3-year old Zainab at that point recites, مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. But Father, the Quran says we have not placed two hearts in the chest of a human being. How can you love me and love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Amir al-Mu'mineen looks, he kisses her on the head, says, Zainab, my heart is only filled with the love of Allah, but I love you for the sake of Allah. I love you only for the sake of Allah. The heart cannot be filled with anything but the love of Allah. This is the greatest ni'mah. This is the greatest ni'mah. In Munajat Sha'baniyah, what do we say? Ilahi, habli kamal al-inqita'i ilayk, wa anir absar qulubina bidhiya'i nadariha ilayk. My Lord, allow me to do kamal al-inqita', to totally cut off from all of those things that seek to distract me from you. And allow the eyes of my heart to view upon you, upon that divine light. And then he continues, so that I can pierce through the curtains that separate me from you. فَتَصِلَ إِلَى مَعْدِنِ الْعَظَمَةِ, so that I can reach the point and gaze upon your true majesty. The heart must be cleansed of all other loves but Allah. Everything that is loved must be loved for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is that batini ni'mah that Allah has given a person. And when you have a ni'mah in your life, that ni'mah has a haqq over you. It has a right over you. And that is that you must thank the one that has bestowed this ni'mah on you. You must thank. It's logical that a person must thank the one that has given them this ni'mah. Imam al-Kadhim salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi says, the ni'mah that is not thanked, the ni'mah for which a person is not thankful, is like the sin that has not been repented for. It's like the sin that has not been repented for. When you're given a blessing, thank Allah for it. Everything that you have in your life is from Allah. Nothing, you do not manifest anything from yourself. So one should da'iman, constantly be in a state of shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your own existence is not even manifested from itself. You are mumkinul wujud. We are only contingent beings. The reason we exist is because he is wajibul wujud. He is the necessary existence. If the necessary existence is alive, I live. But when he chooses, in the same way that I take you back to the example, this necessary existence and contingent existence is what? When I told you to imagine a flower in your head, do you still have that flower? No. You destroyed your creation like that. I distracted you, it went. This is wajib al-wujud and mumkin al-wujud. You are but a thought in Allah. And the moment he chooses no longer to think of you, you no longer exist. Imagine how kareem, how raheem that Lord is, that there are all these billions of people alive and billions in the barzakh, and he is in thought of every single one of them. From the ants, the human beings, right the way through to the blue whale, he's thinking about every single one of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that wajib al-wujud. So one must thank him for the ni'mah that they have within their life. Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam in Risalat al-Huquq, when he talks about, he says, the right of the one who does good to you, who does a good action towards you. He says, the right of the one that does good towards you or does any sort of kind act towards you is that you thank him and mention his kindness. You reward him with beautiful words and you supplicate for him sincerely in that which is between you and Allah. If you do that, then you have thanked him secretly and openly. Then if you are able to repay him one day, you repay him. This is for a human being that has done something good. That's his haqq over you. He's done something good for you. He held open a door for you. He gave you an umbrella. He served you chai. He helped you park your car. We're just like, whatever. That's his job. Not necessarily. To thank the one that does good towards you, thank that person. There's a beautiful narration from Imam al-Sajjad, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ كُلُّ قَلْبٍ حَزِينٍ وَيُحِبُّ كُلُّ عَبْدٍ شَكُورٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves every sad heart and every thankful servant. We'll come to the thankful servant in a moment, but sad heart? Well, Allah likes everyone who's upset or depressed. No, not necessarily. Here, this sadness, and you find it in narrations constantly, that the awliya of Allah have huznu da'im, constant sadness, everlasting sadness in their heart. There's two types of sorrow in the heart of a person, a good one and a bad one. A sorrow that is for the dunya is something that is bad, something that is related to the dunya, and one in that sorrow related to the dunya despairs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah, that's not to say I don't cry when a loved one dies or anything like that. No, you know, that is something that is okay to do, that is recommended when it comes to Sayyidu Shuhada. It is okay to do it as long as you don't start questioning the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah. By the way, I'm not giving psychological advice. That's totally different. Well, I'm not going down that way. I'm just saying generally, in terms of sorrow. We're not talking about depression or anything like that of a clinical matter. So, that sorrow in the heart, there's good and there's bad. The good sorrow that we have is something that is attached to Allah. The bad sorrow is attached to the dunya, leads to a downward spiral, and leads a person to destruction. But the good sorrow is the sorrow that a person takes them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are five types that we have generally within the riwayat that are addressing this type of sorrow. The first is sorrow for the deen. I feel pain when people aren't following the religion properly. It upsets me. I feel upset that people have walked away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That people are not adhering to the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the whole maqsad of Sayyidu Shuhada. وَإِنَّمَا خَرَجْتَ لِطَلَبِ الْإِصْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّي. Or when he writes to the people of Basra, he says that the reason all this is happening, that there is a Yazid on the throne and he is doing what he is doing, is because of two things. أَلَا وَإِنَّ السُنَّةَ قَدْ أُمِيتَتْ. That the sunnah has been killed. Nobody is following the sunnah of the Prophet. وَإِنَّ الْبِدْعَةَ قَدْ أُحْيِيَتْ. And bid'ah, innovation, has been given life within society. So these two reasons of why the society has degraded to having Yazid and accepting Yazid as their leader. Because they left the sunnah of the Prophet. So having that pain of the deen in your heart, the people are not following, people are leaving. And it's not like I walk around and start preaching on corners and, you know, knocking on doors. But it's the fact that with love, I try and bring people back towards the deen. The second thing in the riwayat is sorrow for my own sins in regards to my akhirah. And that's that thing that brings one of the sifat of the mu'min to the fore, and that is al-buka min khashyatillah, The mu'min is the one that wails, buka, not just sits and cries, wails, min khashyatillah, from the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowing the greatness, and this whole fear thing again, it's not like we've always been taught, like fear, he's going to throw me in hell. No, this buka, this fear is fear of the adhama. وَتَصِلَ إِلَىٰ مَعْدِنِ الْأَظَمَةِ When I reach that point, and I come to the realization that, wow, this is wajib al-wujud, I am nothing. If he wanted to get rid of me, I'm just a thought for him. When I reach that, this fear now doesn't come out of he's going to punish me. The fear is I'm sitting in awe of this being, of this Lord of mine that possesses everything. It's the same way when you go and meet one of the Grand Maraja, yeah, and you all and people go in and they sit very like mu'addab in front of, say, Sistani, and yeah, and then when they're about to start, they'll be like, "Sorry, why are you saying sorry for? You didn't do anything wrong." So, I just can't help it because the greatness of this person that is in front of me, it compels me. I shouldn't even be here talking to this person in the presence of this person. Yeah? I mean, I gave Sayyid Sistani as an example, but genuinely one should be like that with their parents, for example. You're that mu'addab. But now that adab is starting to go, I'm just like, "Hey, Dad, do this." You have riwayat when it talks about fathers, says the son, because aqib walidain is one of the gunahani kabira, says when the father looks at the son with anger, Allah classes the son as being aqib walidain, that he's been disowned by his father. Or if the son, other riwayat say, if the son walks ahead of the father out of arrogance, not out of respect of his father, doesn't walk behind him, so he becomes aqib walidain. Allah classifies him as aqib walidain. Do not downplay the greatness of the parents and what maqam the parents have been given. You know, we're out there, we're giving loads of importance to other people, and in our own homes, we have zero importance towards our parents. This will not help you ascend. In fact, it will drag you down to hell. It will drag you down to hell. No one has ever ascended without the dua of their parents. Without the dua of their parents. Recite salawat, please. So having that sorrow in your heart for the akhirah, because of the sins that I've committed. Three, having sorrow in my heart for the creation of Allah that is going on a path of destruction. One of the most greatest examples of this that we have in the Holy Quran is the one of Habib Najjar. وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجَلٌ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ in Surah Yasin. And the man came running from outside of the city and he said to the people, "O people, obey the prophets of God." He was from amongst them. He is known as the Mu'min of Ali Yasin, a man by the name of Habib Najjar. His people turn around, they attack him. So who are you to tell us to follow these people? They attack him, they kill him. But the result of Habib Najjar having the pain in his heart to actually develop his community, to take it forward, to try and save them from damnation, that pain that he had in his heart, for that they killed him. But Allah says what to him? قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ For you there is no questioning. For you there is no qabr. For you there is no fishar. Oh Habib Najjar, قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ You go straight into heaven. You go straight into heaven. What does he say? قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ Even then, they've killed him, they've attacked him, they beat him down, and he's still saying, "I wish my people had just understood." That's what it means to care for your community. We as the next generation have a massive responsibility on our shoulders to take forward this community. The elders have done their jobs in establishing the center. But if I can't be bothered to attend, and I'm talking to those of you around my age who have children of your own, you know, I have this conversation everywhere with people, especially my own friends back home. I'm like, why don't you come to the masjid? Oh, you know what it is? The kids, and they've got to get to bed, and they've got school. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but you realize we used to go, right, and stay all the way up to for Layal al-Qadr until Fajr, and our parents would take us. And you know, yeah, I know, but it's a different time. You know, you can't say these things to your kids. They've got to go to school. And you know, I mean, it was only like 15 years ago. It's not like we're talking 60, 70 years back. Generational change hasn't happened that quick. So, oh no, you know, I go, look, be honest with yourselves. You can't be bothered. And you're using your kids as an excuse. That's the reality. You bring your kids to masjid, they'll be like, yeah, all right, cool, we'll go. Because they get to stay up till like 10, 10:30. No kid's going to be like, oh, bring them. If they want to sleep, let them sleep in the masjid. We're better for them to sleep. At least bring them into the environment. Bring them into the environment. Because there is a spirituality that you will gain here. It's like those people who go into gatherings with alcohol and things. The teachers of akhlaq, and although fiqh says, look, there's no problem. Yeah, if it's not on your table, say Sistani's fatwa is that, right? It's not on your table, and you have to be there. As long as it's not on your table, that's fine. But akhlaq is the paradigm above fiqh. It says even in that circumference, in that area of alcohol, there is a disease, there is a negative energy that is affecting your soul, and you don't see it. You don't perceive it. And over years and years and years of being exposed to that negative energy, it will draw you down. Everything in this world, I said to you, يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Everything in this heaven and earth is doing the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is remembering Allah. There isn't anything that isn't remembering Allah. The natural order of existence is ubudiyah. When someone breaks the natural order and goes, breaking the natural order is sin, and goes in a place like that, the whole of nature turns against them. The whole of nature turns against them. This is why the eighth Imam says, every time there is a new sin that is committed on the earth, Allah sends a new disease into the earth. The more sins that people commit, the more of these new diseases continue to come. Why? Not that Allah is like disease. No, it's a matter of cause and effect. When one goes against the natural order, nature comes to take its revenge. And that's why you have lands that are mal'una and lands that are marhuma. Lands that are cursed and lands that are marhuma. For example, Amir al-Mu'mineen is coming back, I think, from battle from Siffin or one of the or Nahrawan, and he passes a place and they say, look, it's the time for salah. And Amir al-Mu'mineen gets down from his horse and he says, no, not in this land. This land is mal'una. This is a cursed land. And then they ride somewhere further away, and then Amir al-Mu'mineen says, here, this is where we'll pray. And they say, why, mal'una? Says there was some great bloodshed that took place, a great dhulm that took place on that land historically. And so the nature and the energy of the land changes. A place where there's loads of sin being committed, the very energy of that land changes. We may not perceive it, but it is having an effect on your soul by constantly exposing yourself to those places. That's why sometimes people buy a house and they're like, the house feels a bit weird. I don't feel settled in this house. And then, you know, someone come and there's probably a jinn in my house. Can you exorcise my house for me? It's like, no, it's probably not a jinn. It's probably the land that it's built on is mal'una. So you need to do certain a'mal in order to remove that negative energy from that land. But The point was this, that you don't bring your children to this environment, then you won't, or you don't force yourself into this environment, those of the young people that can drive and come and make yourself part of this center, that positive energy will not find itself a place within you. And if I spend my time more outside in mal'una lands, then it will continue to have a negative effect on me. Coming to the masjid is a recharging of oneself. So this whole, it's not the kids. It's not the kids. Those that are watching from home. No, I'm not blaming you. But it's not the kids. Let's get real. Let's be honest with ourselves. It's ourselves, right? I can't be bothered. How my parents did it, God knows. But I can't be bothered. Yeah? But I don't have pain for the nation. That's sorrow. That's the sorrow I need in my heart for my community to progress. And everyone will be questioned. It's not that, I'm going to be questioned, or Maulana Rizvi is going to be questioned, what did you do for the community? No, every single person has upon their shoulders a responsibility. What did you do in order to spread the message of Ahlul Bayt? How did you strengthen the love of Ali Muhammad amongst your people? Every single person has a responsibility. The fourth thing, the fourth pain in the heart is that pain of longing. Longing being separated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not wanting to be separated from Him any longer. See in Dua Kumail, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, Ya ghayat al-a'mal, if you throw me in hell, I'd call out, Ya ghayat al-a'mal al-arifin, Ya ghiyath al-mustaghithin. But at another point he says, فَكَيْفَ أَصْبِرُ عَلَىٰ فِرَاقِكَ. I'll deal with everything, but how will I bear separation from you? How will I bear firaq from you? So even if you throw me in hell in Munajat Sha'baniyah, when adkhaltani an-nar a'lamtu ahlaha anni uhibbuk, but even if you were to throw me into the depth of hell, I would still announce to everyone that I still love you. I still love you. So having that sorrow in one's heart, and then of that separation, and then the sorrow for the awliya of Allah, the tragedy of Sayyidul Shuhada, all of these are the positive sorrows. So the Imam says that Allah loves every sad heart. It's in reference to those, and every thankful servant. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that you have. Allah says to Musa alayhi salam, Musa, thank me. Says, Ya Allah, I can't thank you. Says, Musa, thank me. Says, Ya Allah, I can't thank you. Says, Musa, why? Says, Ya Allah, for every single word of thanks that I utter, I would need to utter another word of thanks that you allowed me to say the first thanks. Allah replies, says, Musa, this is enough thanks for me. That you acknowledge everything that you have is not from you, it is from me. And I have given this to you. Everything is from Allah ultimately. And if one turns away, one likes things in their life, the Holy Quran says, if you like it, you can have more of it. How? La in shakartum, la izidannakum. You thank Him for what you've got, He'll give you more of it. وَلَا إِن كَفَرْتُمْ But if you do كُفْرَانُ النِّعْمَةِ إِنِّي عَذَابِ لَشَدِيدٍ The people of Sabah were a nation who did كُفْرَانُ النِّعْمَةِ They had a beautiful kingdom. Imam Hussein talks about them leaving Medina. He meets a man called Aba Hiram. He says, who is this that leaves the Hajj, leaves the house of God during the time of Hajj? And Imam says, oh, Aba Hiram, they took away our haqq, but we stayed quiet. Now they have come for our blood and we can no longer stay quiet. So I have left Medina. And then Imam says to him, O Aba Hiram, their end shall be like the end of the people of Sabah. The people of Sabah, and then the Imam begins to explain to him, it was a kingdom in Yemen. Bilqis, the queen of Sheba, was the queen of this particular kingdom, maybe many years later. But the people of Sabah were a kingdom in Yemen which had 12 cities. And in the middle of every city, they had a tree that they would worship. And all of these 12 cities were fed by a river called the Tharthar. And all they'd made these tributaries, beautiful gardens, and the people of Sabah were bestowed with ni'mah upon ni'mah. There was no lack of ni'mah for the people of Sabah. They had everything that they want. They had so much abundance of food that it got to the point that the people of Sabah had such an excess of bread, they were using bread to wipe the backsides of their children after they'd been to the toilet. They did this for years. They would wipe it and throw it, and they created a huge mountain-like pile of feces-covered bread. One day, one of the awliya of Allah was walking past. He saw a woman wiping her child's backside with a piece of bread. And he said, "Don't you fear Allah? That is ni'mah from Allah." She says, "What do we have to care about? As long as we have the thar-thar, we're fine." Allah hated her words so much, He sent a drought to the people of Sabah. The thar-thar dried out. All the tributaries dried up. All of their crops failed. A whole drought fell on the people of Sabah. Everything was destroyed. Famine, stricken, nothing to eat. Now the very same people that had an excess of food turned towards the pile of feces covered bread. They took it, they weighed it, and they would give each other that bread to eat. Kufranun ni'am. When Allah has given you a ni'mah, then don't forget to thank Him for it, for He will take it from you. Just to remind you that it was not from you. It was not yours in the first place. The greatest ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has bestowed upon the human being, He has given you clothing, He has given you life, He's given you children, wealth, eyes, ears, touch, the ability to smell, the ability to taste. All of these He gave you and said there's more to come. He gave you life, He said there's more. He gave you touch, He said there's more. He gave you hearing, He said there's more. He gave you ni'mah after ni'mah, He said there's more. Clothing, homes, wives, children, everything. He gave you ni'mah after ni'mah and said there's plenty more where that came from. Keep coming back to me, I'll give it to you. And so He bestowed upon mankind ni'mah upon ni'mah and said there will be more, there will be more, there will be more. But there is only one time that He gave such a ni'mah to mankind that He said after that, this is such a great ni'mah that after this you will need nothing else. There is only one time where He said, "Wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati," that I have completed all of my ni'mah on you, and that is with the wilayat of Ali ibn Abi Talib. They are the peak of the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the peak of the manifestations of the ni'mah of Allah. No, one step further. They are awliya al-ni'am. They are the givers of the ni'mah, the manifestors of that ni'mah. Bi-idhnillah, and they too are the greatest ni'mah. Understanding that. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. They are the greatest ni'mah. And this is why in Ziyarat Jami'a Kabira towards the end, when you look at the true maqam, it says, "Bikum fataha Allah." With you, Allah began everything, O Ali Muhammad. وَبِكُمْ يَخْتِمْ, and with you they shall end it. With you He shall end it. وَبِكُمْ يُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ, and through you He sends rain upon this earth. It's because of you that the rain flows upon this earth. وَبِكُمْ يَمْسِكُ السَّمَاءَ أَن تَقَعَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ, and it is because of you that the sky does not fall down upon the inhabitants of the earth. For they are the arkan al-bilad. They are the pillars. Don't just think that they are just entities here. No, in the malakut, the whole power that drives this alam, they are the batin of the malakut. Don't just sit there. They are the malakut. They are Lohi Mahfuz. They are Kitabun Mubin. They are all of these things that drives everything. Anything that comes from Allah, any ni'mah that comes from Allah goes through them and comes to the earth. Ya Ali, Ya Ali. Everything goes through them. And so don't forget your imam. Today, one of the great scholars, Allah bless his soul, Ayatollah Nasiri, passed away in Iran. One of the awliya of Allah, one of those alimi rabbani. I was listening to one of his clips, and he was saying that don't ever forget your imam. Because it says, by Allah, your imam is not ghafil of you for even one moment. Your imam is da'iman, constantly thinking about you. And then he says, wallah, he knows all of your actions and all of your thoughts. Says, if you want success in the dunya and the akhirah, says, do tawassul to Imam Zaman. So you just do tawassul to your imam. He will give you the dunya and the akhirah. The imams, awliya and na'am, running the world from the malakut, their energy is what keeps existence existing. Bi'idhnillah, through the permission of God. And so turn to them, do tawassul. But with all this greatness, one becomes baffled at how it is that this ummah could do that zulm to them. That which was seen in Karbala. There are many difficult moments in Karbala. That question that Zainab asked just after Asr Ashur is a very difficult question. What was the question that Zainab alayha salam asked? Often we hear that Zainab said, Sajjad, should we burn alive in the tents or should we go out? But there was a question that she asked Imam al-Husayn, Imam al-Sajjad before that. The narration says there was the sound of shattering glass that was heard through the earth of Karbala after the Shahadat of Sayyid al-Shahada. She said to him, Sajjad, what was that? He says, oh, Auntie Zainab, they've started trampling the body of my father under the hooves of the horses. That sound was the sound of the breaking of the ribs of my father, Abu Abdullah. But in Ziyaratul Nahiya, it appears that the body of Sayyidul Shuhada was trampled twice. Because in Ziyarat Nahiya Muqaddasa, Imam Zaman says, my salams be upon my grandfather that fell from the running horse to the ground and the horses trampled his body as he was lying there. That was the first time his body was trampled. The second time his body was trampled was after his shahadat. What dhulm did they not do upon Aba Abdullah? That on the 12th of Muharram, on the 11th of Muharram, when Zainab alayha salam was being taken, every single one of the women, she helped them get onto their camels. Now all of them were mounted upon their camels. فَنَذَرَتْ شِمَالٍ وَيَمِينَا Zainab looked to her left and she looked to her right and she called out, Wa Abbasa, Wa Akbara, Wa Husayna, oh, where are you all? When I came to Karbala, you were all there to take me down from the camel. You surrounded me from all four sides. Now Zainab is leaving. Where are you all? At that moment, Sajjad comes forward. Oh, Auntie Zainab, Sajjad will help you get on top of your camel. Zainab alayha salam, hands tied around her neck. They take the bodies they take the camels of the women through the bodies of the shuhada. In Islamic warfare, this is haram. That the prisoner should never be taken past the bodies of those that have been killed. But here, the daughters of Ali and Zahra. See, in Islamic warfare, they say even if you fight against the kuffar, don't take the kuffar past the bodies of their loved ones. Here, the daughters of Ali and Zahra are being taken through the bodies of Bani Hashim. They say that Zainab saw in the distance a pile of stones and spears and arrows protruding from it. Zainab threw herself from the camel to the ground, to the earth of Karbala. How is it Zainab fell? Ali Akbar fell from his horse. But Ali Akbar was a young man and he fell from the height of a horse. Yes, Qasim was young. But still, Qasim was a young man and he fell from the height of a horse. Abbas, yes, Abbas's arms were cut. But Abbas fell from the height of a horse. Yes, he fell upon his face. But Abbas was a man and he was falling from the height of a horse. Here on the 11th of Muharram, Zainab is a lady. She's falling from the height of a camel and her hands are tied around her neck. Tell me how it is that Bint Zahra fell from that camel. They say Zainab's face hit the earth of Karbala. She stood up and she ran. And then she sat. Then she stood again and she ran and she sat. Then she stood again and ran and sat. And then she reached the body. They say, why is it Zainab ran and sat? Say, maybe one of the reasons was this, that Zainab was tired from Sham-e Ghariban. Zainab was tired from Sham-e Ghariban. She couldn't sustain that amount of running. All night she had taken on the role of Abbas for the children of Abi Abdullah. So Zainab's energy was drained. But they say the second reason, and the most probable, because the maqatil, when they refer to the death of Sayyid al-Shuhada, they say فَقَتَّعُوهُ بِصَيُوفِهِمْ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا, that the body of Hussein was mutilated after his death. Then on top of that, they ran their horses over his body. وَمُقَتَّعُ الْأَعْضَى, limbs of Hussein became separated. Now Zainab runs to her brother. She comes across a limb of Hussein. She sits down on the ground. She kisses it, runs again, and she sees a limb of her brother until she reaches that pile of stones. And the only thing Zainab can say, looking at the state of her brother, is, "Ha anta akhi, are you my brother Hussein?" ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, forgive our sins. Ya Allah, forgive the sins of our parents. Ya Allah, to those of our parents that are alive, give them long lives. Those of our parents that have left this world, give them place next to Ali Muhammad in Jannah. Oh Allah, those who are ill, give them shifa'ah. Those who are in debt, clear their debts. Ya Allah, fulfill the hajat of those that have brought hajat to this majlis. Ya Allah, dispel the difficulties and sorrows of all those in attendance of this majlis. Ya Allah, give us tawfiq to go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein this year and every year. Ya Allah, keep safe the azadar of Sayyid al-Shuhada around the world. Ya Allah, hasten the reappearance of the Imam of our time and allow us to be amongst his true muntadhirin, Matami Hussein.
Ya Hussein! Ya Hussein!